Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, everybody, for coming out. I'm incredibly honored to be here and to be able to talk about these incredibly important topics, both to our community, to our country, and honestly, to the world. My name is Christopher Poulos, and I'm president of the American Constitution Society at the University of Maine School of Law, and I will be graduating in a couple weeks, I hope, assuming that I get through my last round of exams. My health has been poor for the last several weeks, but I believe I'm on the mend and on the home stretch now, which I'm looking forward to. I just wanted to share quickly my appreciation for the American Constitution Society at the University of Maine School of Law. It's been wonderful to serve as the president for the last 2 years. And Jackie, is Jackie here?
Yeah.
Jackie actually really, in many ways, founded the organization, or at least breathed life into it when I was a 1L, and that's how all of this started, was with Jackie, who's now practicing law here in Portland. So tonight's topic is something that I have wanted to have for a couple of years now, at least 2 years. My focus was really on mass incarceration and the number of people we have incarcerated here in the United States. Back in 1970, we had only about 200,000 people incarcerated, and now we have over 2.2 million, somewhere between 2.2 and 2.3 million. It's a 600% increase, or at least over 500% increase in the last several decades. And a lot of that increase, not all of it, but a lot of it has to do with the war on drugs and the way we treat addiction. And do we want to consider addiction a moral weakness or a treatable health condition? And what's more effective? What's the best way to get people help? So this fall, I had the honor of serving at the Office of National Drug Control Policy, and I worked specifically in a department there called the Recovery Branch, which is really cool. The idea that the tip of the spear for international drug interdiction also has a branch of the office called the Recovery Branch. And for the first time since the war on drugs was started, the president has actually proposed a budget to Congress that allocates more money to prevention, treatment, and long-term recovery than it does to interdiction and supply reduction. And that's a fundamental shift that has happened. And what I learned in that position that I had this fall was that without addressing the underlying issues of addiction, we can't address mass incarceration. The two issues are completely intertwined, interrelated, and if we let a lot of folks out of jail and prison but don't address the underlying issues, we're in a tough situation. And so my work really involves bringing the recovery advocacy folks together, the people that work in addiction, work around recovery, in the same rooms, into the same discussions as those who are seeking to address the mass incarceration that we have in this country. And as a lot of you know, I think probably, actually, let's do this. How many people in this room know someone who has been in some way touched by either alcohol or drug addiction? I think that just about everybody, if not everyone. So this epidemic affects everyone in our community. It really does, either directly or indirectly. Someone we know has been touched by addiction. Someone we know may have died, or many people may have died from addiction. And also the criminal justice system's component as part of that. So I just wanted to quickly thank everyone for being here. And I'd like to welcome our first speaker tonight, who is University of Southern Maine President Glenn Cummings. I'm actually a University of Southern Maine alumni myself, or alumnus. Alumnus, I always get confused on the plural there. But Glenn is a longtime Mainer. Glenn recognizes the importance of these issues, and we're honored to have him here. We're also very honored to have E. Smith from Senator King's office join us, because the senator recognizes the importance of this issue, and everybody in every field at this point right now is working on this stuff, and we're hoping that we can really turn this moment into a movement that is able to be sustainable. So I'd like to welcome up USM President Glenn Clemmings.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, everybody, for being here. And so it's a great moment for me to say publicly my admiration for Chris. What a gift it is to have a man like Chris in our midst as a USM graduate, undergraduate, and soon to be a law graduate. This is a man who has lived his life in a movement over the last few years to a culmination of taking his experiences in life and trying to help other people. And for me, there's no better expression of a university than people who graduate and say, what can I do? What is my unique gift? What is the unique part of my story that I could share and help with somebody else? So please join me in thanking Chris for his leadership. I just want to say, first of all, I'm not nervous today because if I make a mistake, it can't be as bad as what I just experienced about 2 hours ago when I was out at the USM men's baseball game and everybody's excited. And the announcer from the sound booth said, please, everybody, stand up, and I will now play the national anthem. So whatever he was playing, now this guy's probably in his late 60s, he's not used to computers, so whatever he pressed, I think sounded more like Maroon 5, and he can't figure out how to get it to stop. So everybody's standing there with their hands on their heart, and they're baseball cats beside them going, what is going on here? So if I screw up, at least I have a standard that's been set. Let me say, I'm so glad you picked this topic. Last year in New Hampshire, the state next door, every single day, somebody died of an opioid addiction in that state. And this state, not far behind it, about 200 people. We look at this, beautiful. This is one of the best small cities in America that you're seeing up here. Best small cities in America according to 5 magazines. And in those streets are people who are life or death at this moment because of this disease. This is not a low socioeconomic disease. This is not anything to do with your profession. It is not to do even with your religion, your mindset. It is a disease that can strike anybody at any time. What the role of a great university is we begin to help people think about what something that is haunting your society. Think about what we can do better. If we really believed it was a disease, I don't think that some of the things you hear said would be said. If we really took that seriously, we would say, no, we don't treat people like that if they have a disease. And the way we handle this in our policy, the people who are involved have to find ways in which they support each other. And it is a place, in my position, this could be disagreed with, I'm not a medical doctor. I think it's a disease in which there is not a cure, but there are solutions. And we have to come together as a society that says, what are those solutions? If a university is as great as what I think USM is and know it is, then it will be part of that conversation. It will be part of that conversation in a deep way. Tonight we have invited people to come and begin that discussion, that conversation, here at this university. We have had students who have come to me and said, you can't educate all of the students at USM well unless you educate and support the people who are in recovery from drugs and alcohol. I love that conversation. You come to the college president and you say, I need your help to create a university that really gets what we have to do and your responsibility in terms of drugs and alcohol. Help me work with others to do this. And these students came to me with a proposal, I'm not exaggerating, I have never seen professional grant writers write such a great proposal for funding to try to get us the support, the programmatic support, and our long-term dream is to have a place that is a completely sober dorm on campus where they can support each other, work with each other and make themselves successful, not just in their recovery, but as an academic part of their recovery as well. Steve and Susie Schwartz just committed $1 million to that dream. I'm like, thank you. I got a little excited. We're going to get there. I'm honored to also say that we have with us, amongst us, a man who has a multi-decade, fabulous international reputation as a criminal defense attorney. And he's also just written a great book called Excellence in Cross-Examination. Some of you law students are finishing up your school year might want to grab this immediately on the way out. And if you're a husband or wife, you might want to get this too. Just trying to promote that. And this is a man who has chosen to spend his last 5 or 6 years with us here in Yarmouth, but he has told me that he has, grandfather bought his house on Princess Point in Yarmouth in 1932 for $400. So not only is he smart, but he's shrewd too. And he comes from good genes. One of the most renowned criminal defense attorneys in the world. We are delighted to have him with us. He's going to talk a little bit about some of these changing issues. He's going to refer to some of the issues that I just talked about the disease of substance, drug and alcohol abuse. And it is an honor, a true honor, to have F. Lee Bailey with us today. I'm asking him to step forward. Please give him a big round of applause.
Is anybody in the room older than 83? All right, let's get something perfectly straight. I am the senior person in this room, in the state of Maine. I came here in a bassinet when I was 4 weeks old. And my grandfather did have a place for which he paid $400 in 1922, not 32, but all the same. That was a lot of money then. You could buy a house for $400. I loved Princess Point. I called it Green Maine. To me, there were two major events in the year. One was Christmas, try to get Santa Claus in that chimney, and the other was to go to Green Maine in June every year until we closed the place in September. As I recall, it didn't have much heat. And I resolved over and over again, because I came back over and over again by boat, by plane, as a guest, as a hotel tenant, but I would settle down in Maine when it was time to settle down, something that's not easy to do if you have an extra 500 horsepower built in by accident and like to keep busy. Now, I am very, very impressed that one person, and I know he's not alone, could come from as far down as Chris Poulos has and be on the cusp of getting a law degree and I'm sure membership in the bar. The most satisfying case I ever had overall, even though the ending was somewhat tragic, although not related to litigation, was the case of Dr. Sam Shepard. Some of you who are closer to my age remember The Fugitive. That was a takeoff on that very real case. But when I was introduced to him, he had lost 11 appeals and was doing life for killing his wife, which I sensed right away he hadn't done and agreed to get him out. Now, most lawyers wouldn't agree to get someone out who'd lost 11 appeals. But I was 28. I was not long out of the Marine Corps, where I learned to do two things. One was fly jets, and the other was kick ass and take names. And so the system was there. I had a little help from some friends in Washington called the U.S. Supreme Court. They came down with three decisions on the same day. And I termed it, in a law review article, that event, the Charles Revolution. Because in those three cases, Fay against Noya, Wainwright against Getgu, same, and Sanders v. the United States, all of the inmates, all doing big time, were name charged. They were all given hearings in federal habeas corpus, a door that had been closed almost all the way prior to that, and a lot of substandard state-run convictions, and some fed were thereafter set aside. Sam Shepard was one of them. We went back to trial. He was summarily acquitted. And by the way, for those of you who may try some cases, it is always good to have an ace in the jury box. It's also a good way to lose your license. Unless it is a product of happenstance. In this case, in 1966, in the retrial of Sam Shepard, the fugitive was a raging success. It involved a doctor who had not killed his wife, but been convicted and given life, escaped, was on the run looking for the culprit, just as Sam Shepard was looking for a bushy-headed man that probably killed his wife. This was a one-armed man, and the series went on and on. And I knew that of the jurors we put in the box in Cleveland, could not get a change of venue, even though feelings were still pretty strong with the older crowd, I knew that most of those people watched The Fugitive at least part of the time. And everybody knew the fugitive was innocent. So I never asked a question on voir dire about that. And the prosecutor either didn't think of it or was afraid to. And the jury very quickly disposed of the case. I'm not recommending that you try and put together that matrix of circumstances if you're actually trying a case, but it's very good to bump into by coincidence. I have a long and abiding interest in prison reform for several reasons. One of them is that I became acquainted with the prison system by going there. My very first case of consequence was a capital case, and a bunch followed thereafter. And in those cases, you don't have the defendant come to your office, you go see him. And so I got to look at the circumstances. 7 years after I began to practice, a blues singer, known as the King, named B.B. King, got in touch with me. He said, you know, I go to the prisons all the time, and I offer them entertainment and a chance to be lighthearted for a few minutes and listen to some good music, and I pay for them. And I'm wondering if you would go with me and speak to the prisoners, give them some encouragement, because I look at them and I say, there but for the grace of God go I. Just as O.J. Simpson almost turned out to be a thug and instead wound up being a Heisman Trophy winner for a number of reasons that are part of a different lecture, B.B. King had pulled himself up to be the best at what he did, and he was grateful for it. Last time I saw him a couple of years ago, I took my partner, Debbie Elliott, with me. We sat in his trailer. B.B. never flew anywhere. We sat on stage during his performance. One fellow tried to make out with Debbie on stage. I chased him out, waving my Marine Corps saber. But it was a very pleasant evening. And my lecture had to do with how to get out. Now, if you want to draw a crowd in prison, on a lecture voluntary, you give a talk on how to get out. I think many were disappointed because although I said, and it wound up, the wardens loved this at first, they didn't like the idea. I said, why don't you put in law libraries instead of sticking chips into each other out in the yard? These guys go read cases, looking for one that gives them the key to the jail. And the prisons began to do that. And I think B.B. and I probably visited several dozen he did more where I didn't attend for one reason or another. But I could see a glimmer that there was something to say, because of the practice of criminal defense, there is nothing more discouraging than saving somebody from the guillotine or a 10-year sentence or whatever, and watching them walk down the street with the pretty sure knowledge that they would be back. There is no room in the United States of America, as any corporate executive will tell you, for an organization that fails 70% of the time. And if the index of failure is recidivism, that is an inmate who leaves and commits another crime and comes back, that is the rate at which our prison system does not accomplish what we say it is out to do, and that is correction. There is very little correction. Efforts vary inside various institutions. Many are now offering internet and internet education, and all of this is positive, but has not had a huge impact yet. When I first came to Maine, I focused on this problem, because the B.B. King Coalition was only one of many things I had been doing in prison reform. The second was, I was spokesman for a program in Minneapolis. And if you ever get kicked out of Maine, go to Minnesota. They don't have an ocean, but they've got the same kind of people. And you would love them. They're a joy to see every day, unlike some other places that I lived. Some businessmen in Minnesota, together with a 32-year-old commissioner of corrections — this is a great place for young spirit, the corrections business — decided to try an experiment. The thesis was that if people had some alternatives, they wouldn't get out of prison and go rob a grocery store when they found out they couldn't get work and nobody wanted to talk to them or have dinner with them, and they're probably better off back inside anyway. And many developed that attitude. The program was called Amicus. It conscripted businessmen to take responsibility for an emerging inmate. The inmate would be released early so one could keep his hooks in him and bring him back if he didn't cut it. They would get a job, the businessman would tell his employees, this person's a convict, and I want you to try and help him out and teach him a little bit about life, because he sure hasn't learned much about it in prison that is worthwhile, except hard to survive. And that program worked swimmingly by this measuring stick. The recidivism rate in Minnesota for those who were in the Amicus program dropped from 72% to 22%. That is remarkable. I lectured about this back in June of 09 at Eggs and Issues, and there was an attractive young lady in the audience who took it to heart. And she said, by golly, somebody should provide better opportunities for these convicts to get a job and hold on to a job and stop using a pistol as a means of support. And she started a company called Maine Works. It takes inmates and gets them jobs on a temp basis. If they have drug and alcohol problems they don't successfully address, they're not eligible. But her recidivism rate, Margot Walsh, who deserves a tremendous amount of credit, and I hope will spread across the state of Maine and elsewhere with her program, her recidivism rate among those who don't depart for alcohol or drug abuse is very low, probably better than the Amicus program. Now, these are the seedlings from which a system might be structured. Let's flip the coin over and take a look at the ugly side. First of all, we all complain about opiate and other addictions that cause people to engage in aberrative conduct, often violent and sometimes homicidal. But the greatest seat of circulation of drugs in the United States of America is in the prisons. No one has ever been able to keep drugs from coming into the system for some reason. Federal, they do better than state, but it's still there. If people are going to find solace in the misery of being an inmate by getting high on anything, they are not going to equip themselves to deal with society, which is no free lunch, as all of us know, if and when they are released. That's problem number one, and it's out there, and it is not addressed in a meaningful way. If you can't hammer guards and visitors who are bringing dope into a prison into the belief that they will surely be drawn and quartered if they get caught, then you're not a very tough guy, and you've got to be tough to do a good job in the prison. That needs to be addressed. Number two, I always get a kick out of the notion that when someone gets released, a tough inmate who had to wrap up his time didn't get paroled, and therefore when he's cut loose, he is loose. There are no ties and no restraints. He is given a suit, usually worth about $40, and $40, and told, go become a big success. And that's why 70% do not. Now, there's a lot of available time in prisons. People don't have much to do unless the prison gives it to them. If getting some education were a criterion to assist in early release, lots of people would do it, and putting the computers in, making the courses available is not difficult, as has been shown. But the problem with our perception of prison inmates is these are bad people. Some would say they'll always be bad no matter what we do, so let's just throw away the key and let's not have to worry about it. That's too unpleasant. They've offended. They don't deserve our concern. Much of that is true. And they may be bad people, but they're your bad people. And when they get out, they'll continue to be your bad people. And it's like letting out the fence in a leper colony. Not a good idea. It is a spreading contamination. Back on the bright side, Maine is probably the ideal state. And I have been in court, and therefore in prison, in every state but Montana. It is probably the ideal state for steps to be taken to improve the prison system for several very practical reasons. Number one, there are not a large percentage of minorities in this state, where in some states it's well over 50, particularly blacks and Hispanics in the Southwest. Therefore, there is not much of a tendency in any of the prisons in Maine that I've been in, and that's most of the big ones, to form gangs who are impossible to deal with in a policy, incentive, or other basis. They have other fixations on life, and prying them loose from that loyalty is very difficult. The prison population is not terribly big. However, when you want to find jobs for these people getting out, everybody has been laying people off, not hiring, for quite a number of years. Now, when I go to Ed and say, Ed, John here is being released in a week, I wonder if you could give him some kind of job so that he could feed himself. Ed says, well, I just laid off my brother and two sisters-in-law. And you think I should leave them out on the street and hire this guy who's been out robbing banks? I don't think so. Whereas when we ran the amicus program, jobs were plentiful and we didn't run into that barrier. Now, how does all of this relate to the global problem? And it's kind of startling that the state generally is elderly, well-forested, and quiet, as the state of Maine can have so many dopers. Not only those who sell, but those who use. Well, one reason developed years ago when people were getting caught bringing marijuana and other substances into the Carolinas. And they found that the coast of Maine is absolutely indefensible. The Coast Guard couldn't defend this coast against speedboats that were full of grass if we put all of its resources in port. Just can't be done, and there was a huge influx. So people who didn't care about the state, didn't live here, didn't even want to visit, found it was a good way to make money, and began to infiltrate, and I'm sure took hold. That was years ago. That hasn't happened on the coast of Maine for quite a while that I know of. But the whole business of drug addiction is so closely intertwined, maybe our mistake, but it's there, with the penal system, that you cannot address one, in my view, without the other. Just as if you're going to equip inmates to come out and not be addicted, you can't feed it to them in prison, whatever it is you're trying to break. Drying out, as Frank Sinatra's classic film, The Man with the Golden Arm, he had a heroin addiction. He was playing really the part of Gene Krupa, the famous drummer, showed that breaking loose from a heroin addiction or any of the heavy opiates is a terrible experience. It hurts, it makes you miserable, and so forth. But before there was methadone and other easing chemicals to try to help get through that stage, people just had to do it. And one place you can dry someone else, someone out, is in confinement, where you have control of them if you will exercise that control. As to those who are not confined, what to do? How does one tell people that try something one time and it feels good? And let's face it, as with the problem with alcohol, which began with prohibition and ended when I was born in 1933. Apparently the powers that be felt that I'd be coming down the pike and I wouldn't put up with prohibition, so they decided to throw in the towel. But that ended. It didn't end the problem, but regulation turned out to be better. Thousands of crimes are committed every month in the United States because people are too drunk. I want to point out parenthetically, since it's on the front page this week and last week and next week, that pot has been bad rapped. Ever since the days when we watched Robert Mitchum do 30 days for smoking local weed, it has been known as evil hemp and all kind of bad things. It has made a lot of people a lot of money simply because it had been unlawful. I will tell you, I think every lawyer worth his salt who has been knocking around in the criminal justice system will tell you, I never had a case where somebody committed a crime because they were high on drugs, on dope spelled marijuana. The marijuana people that I've encountered either go off in a corner and listen to music, or they go off in a corner and do something naughty, or they eat too much. But they don't run around shooting people or beating them up with clubs or stealing. As a rule, they are happy folks, at least till a hangover hits. Grouping that substance together with real killers like opium, heroin, any of the main painkillers, which are very bad and are stolen on a daily basis to feed habits, was a mistake, and hopefully it is now unraveling as state by state said it wasn't worth it. Why we didn't learn from Prohibition that if the people want something, they're damn well going to find a way to get it, no matter what we do with the legislature, I don't know. But we certainly didn't learn. The leaf is beginning to turn. I don't think that marijuana is at the base of the troubles that we generally group together with opiates. People who cannot break free from an addiction don't have, and this is a very large group of people, the intestinal fortitude to simply will what they will accomplish. It's like going in for a root canal. Never pleasant to contemplate and not often much fun when it's going on. But you feel better when it's done. And almost all of these addicts would feel much better and be much better if they had help in getting rid of the problem. I think that is a combination of many human skills and endeavors. Certainly education is a factor. And I don't think there's enough of that in schools. You can scold kids for going out behind the barn and having a joint or even a nicotine cigarette, but that hasn't been shown to impress most of them. Something more is needed that will reach them. Now, I will fall back on a defining experience in my life, which I think can be extrapolated to work in other circumstances. When I began to practice law, if you could take a young offender, juvenile or close to it, and get the military to accept it, the odds were strong. They would straighten him out. Maybe her, but there weren't many hers back then. Because they don't put up with any nonsense, and they have both the means and the will to impose discipline. The 4.5 years that I spent in the Navy and Marine Corps, ultimately as a jet fighter pilot, were a total change in my attitude. I had always been aggressive, enthusiastic, ambitious, or as my mother said, often wrong, but never in doubt. But I didn't know what things to really be frightened about, other than things that go bump in the night and not be frightened about. Well, I found out pretty quick when I got to boot camp. You should be frightened of the drill sergeant even if you outrank him. I was an aviation cadet who really didn't have any rank. You better follow orders because the consequences of not doing so aren't pleasant. And you also have to learn how to give orders if you're going to be something more than a lowly enlisted type. Those lessons took hold, and they were not passed just to me, but to my colleagues and others. I must tell you, in the 1950s, which a few of you might remember, we kind of had our Halley Sundays, aside from the Korean War, which ended the minute they heard in Korea that I was coming because I was getting my wings. It was the Americans who were afraid and wanted the troops, not the other side. I wasn't the best shot in the world on that fighter plane. But other than that, life was good. If you made $100 a week, you lived pretty well. You could get a new car for $1,800. And although most kids didn't get to go to college, everybody was thought to have a chance. Things kind of unwound from there. Dope didn't really become a big problem in this country until the 60s, when the Vietnam War had everybody spinning out of control, the kids burning flags, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm not sure we have recovered from that. What I'm not sure of that's much worse is I'm not sure that this country has the will, the determination and the stamina And without all three, forget about it. You're not going to get there. To address this problem, not once, but over and over again, to address offenders, some of them not once, but twice or three times, and some many times, and keep trying to insert those crutches without which they cannot walk. They can learn to walk, but most of them who are sorely addicted cannot walk without some kind of crutch, either somebody giving them money or getting money by stealing it or in some other way. And this is not a problem, although it gets lots of ink, particularly when it hits close to home, as some of these recent drug cases appear to have done. This is not a problem which is at the top of human consciousness. Now, there are several ways to solve it. One is to throw out everybody we might think is a criminal and build a wall. Mexico and probably Canada as well, although they don't send us many criminals, I'm pleased to say. The other is to bar all bad people from coming into the United States, particularly if they're Muslim. We've heard that. And the third is to carpet bomb the offenders wherever they are found. I don't believe any of those is going to turn out to be a panacea. I think that we've got to treat drug addiction in a much more logical way. I am not really pleased with the contribution made so far by medical science. I believe that with a proper effort, and nobody gives money for this purpose that I know of, or very little, with proper concentration, just as we saw a young man named Parker who made a fortune with, I believe, Facebook, gave $250 million yesterday to root out and solve cancer, just as we went to the moon in the 60s. Put enough money in it, it will help. Well, money certainly does help. Unless we take that kind of interest, this process is going to dawdle on, lumbering from generation to generation without substantial improvement. If there were a chemical treatment that would cure addiction or diminish it or make it more controllable, I'm sure that society would run to meet it, because the alternative that we now confront is a long and difficult process. And the worst part is it fails so often that people throw in the towel and go, they give up. So we're caught in a cycle. Whether with all of the turmoil that heads of state and important government people have to confront today, whether it's in Washington or Augusta or Tehran, it is not likely that addiction is going to get first place in the line of urgent things to be accomplished. But as long as there are those who will take a crack at it, Chris Bullitt, Margo Walsh, and a bunch of others who have shrugged off or helped others shrug off the stain, and it is a stain of a felony conviction, and get a new grip on life and a new start. Nelson Eddy once said in the famous quasi-opera, I guess, just give me 10 who are stout-hearted men and I'll soon give you 10,000 more. This is not a popular undertaking. We don't give out medals, kudos, promotions, raises, or other things to people who deal with the very difficult, not only sociopath, as many of them are. They were kicked around enough as kids, so they think survival, but they don't think, I wonder if I'm hurting anyone. And it's just too easy to give up. In my view, anytime you undertake a project which can be done. And absent some intervening circumstance like a change in health, death of a loved one that turns life upside down, those who don't get to the finish line simply didn't want to get there badly enough. The most important thing ever said to me when I was young and listening carefully to what adults said was that you can have just about anything in life if you want it badly enough. But don't underestimate the size of that element. You may have to want it really badly to get there. And I believe, by and large, that within each person's limitations, if tough goals are set and pursued and encouraged, whether it be not holding up a store to get your income or cans of food, or not taking a needleful of whatever it is being boiled down in the spoon that day, that with group impetus, group therapy is an effective, in many cases, means, and individual impetus, we can make progress. You and I, particularly you, will never live to see the day where drug addiction is gone. Too many people get used to morphine, other drugs, in hospital settings, including a lot of doctors, I must tell you, whose names you've never heard because we got them out of the problem before it festered. But those who are exposed to drugs will always be drawn to them. But the problem could be diminished. It could be much less of a nightmare for law enforcement, which suffers mightily. And I know an awful lot of law enforcement guys. As a matter of fact, somebody once said to me, I see you with the cops more often than the lawyers. And I reminded him what the Vermonter had said to a visitor in that great state. He said, I understand you've got more cows than people in Vermont. Why is that? He said, we prefer. But they do. They do a tough job. There's not much thanks in it. And they deal with some very difficult people. And some of them get inured to that. Say, this guy isn't worth any effort to try and set him straight. He'll be back here next week. And of course, partly because of that attitude, and partly because at the law enforcement level, they're not equipped to do a whole lot. They are correct too much of the time. Now, Mark Twain once said, everybody talks about the weather, but nobody does anything. And that is true of more than half of all the important things that pass our way in the course of life in these United States and elsewhere. There's one thing that you must understand, particularly about America. Early in the game, Americans have the attention span of a four-year-old. Get them all excited about something on Monday, and then bring in a new element on Thursday, and Monday's faded into distant memory. If it were not for that failing, I can't imagine that Prohibition would not have taught lessons that prevented the enormous amount of damage that's done by jailing non-criminals who are drug-connected, either as addicts or, and this is the difficult case in my view, the addict who is not out there selling drugs, although he may get to that spot, but committing crimes to get the drugs to face or serve his own addiction. This is a potpourri of different kinds of problems all in the same mixing bowl. There is no magic wand that I can conceive of and no panacea that I know about. it is a combination of people like Chris setting an example, people like Margot creating the jobs that inmates just can't get too much of the time, that are chipping away at. Unless we get more involvement by people who should be touched by all of this, and I mean the lawyers and others opposing the social services, not only ruminating and moaning about how bad things are in the drug field, but doing something about it. We used to say in the Marine Corps that inaction is suicidal. In other words, do something, even if it's wrong. Don't sit on your backside. Well, that would be a pretty good jump start if we could sell it to the population that is not really anxious to get its hands dirty by consorting with criminals, inmates, but still is very unhappy with that segment of society that touches too many of us. And then when lightning strikes and somebody who is drunk out of his mind or high on some dangerous opiate randomly shoots a spouse or a child or a loved one, suddenly the impact is there, but as to that case, it's too late. So I offer no golden book with truth nestled between its covers. I do offer 50 years of being in the system, worrying about it, trying to help out a little here and there, but I make no claim as to major contributions. And I'm sure that our panel will be able to shed from various perspectives different kinds of help that we might consider, because this is not an area where anyone has found a touchstone that has the answer. Now, I'm told that our distinguished panel will be at the ready whenever I choose to drop the hammer. And by dropping the hammer, I mean I have the pleasure, honor, and distinct recollection of a luncheon several months ago with the relatively new dean of this distinguished law school, Danielle Conway, who will now come and introduce the panel. Woo!
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Christopher Pullis, with the American Constitutional Society and the University of Maine School of Law students who work so diligently to put this program together. This is one of the highlights of the University of Maine School of Law, watching our students do powerful and impactful things. And they are the ones that have drawn you here tonight. So please, let's give them a hand. I'd like to invite the panel up to the chairs to my left. First, Alison Beyea. She's the Executive Director of the ACLU of Maine. She oversees the organization's legal and legislative, public education, and development activities. Next up, Jamesa Drake. I'm happy to say that she gives of her time not just in appellate criminal representation, but she also teaches at the University of Maine School of Law criminal procedure. She teaches the students so well that they actually have the opportunity to actually win some cases against you in court. Do you just let them win? Just, you know, to make them feel good? She is teaching them so well. But Jamesa has a wonderful background. She has a very specialized practice in appellate litigation. She's based here in Maine, but she travels across the country representing people who have been convicted and who want to appeal for any number of reasons. She's argued in front of the U.S. Supreme Court, as well as many of the circuits around the country. I think what is so impressive about Jamesa is that not only is she representing individuals who need representation, let me say it one more time, individuals, yes, who have been convicted, still need representation. That is the rule of law at work. But she also does a lot of pro bono work, which we greatly appreciate. She does that here and around the country. So thank you, Jamesa, for being here. And then Lenny Smith. Lenny Smith is from Plymouth House. He's a graduate of Yale University. He went to Portland High School, which is probably much more important. And at Plymouth House, he is involved in a program that is committed to the 12-step program. The Plymouth House is a retreat dedicated to teaching the life-changing principles and practices of the 12 steps, while offering a safe and healthy environment for recovery from addiction. The 12 steps has helped millions to overcome their addictions, help them to remain sober and to enjoy a full life and to be productive community citizens. Fantastic. And then last but not least is our very own Chief Michael Sauschuck. Is that right?
Mike is outstanding. That's perfect.
I have very little ego, so I actually would love to know how you pronounce it.
Sauschuck.
Sauschuck. Yeah. Thank you. I am teachable. Police Chief Michael Sauschuck has served the city of Portland since 1997, when he began his law enforcement career as a patrol officer. Chief Sauschuck was appointed Chief of Police in January of 2012. He leads a team of highly trained professional men and women committed to the department's core values of leadership, integrity, and service. So thank you, panelists, for coming here to talk about this very important topic that the students have put together. And it is called At the Intersection of Criminal Justice System Involvement and Addiction Recovery. And I think one important thing here is narrative. I think that's what we can draw from F. Lee Bailey's speech, is narrative. How are we going to begin to talk about these things as opposed to using words like criminal or addict or, what are some of the words that you hear?
Felon.
Felon. Thank you. Thank you.
Junkie.
Junkie. I like this. This is like school. Give me a couple more. I'll be doing law school. Give me a couple more. Crackhead. Oh, thank you. Can I add one? Welfare queen. Gotta love that one. Right. So, narrative is so important. And while we have things like freedom of expression and citizens' rights to be safe, we also have an important counter-narrative. And that counter-narrative is what we're here to talk about. So, I think the first question I'd like to ask is, when did you first confront these narratives? And maybe I'm talking to the chief. And how have you been able to transition from those narratives?
Yeah, I think for me, I've had a great education really over the last several years. I can tell you, having been a police officer since 97 in the city of Portland, as various points in my career, I was a special agent with Maine Drug Enforcement in Cumberland County. I also ran the Cumberland County Drug Task Force for MDEA. So I've said 1,000 times in various settings, not only is there a war on drugs, I was a warrior in the war on drugs, right? Mm. So that was my job, is to go out and certainly in that time frame, arrest people and take them to jail. Because that was the only answer, and everybody was getting arrested, and everybody went. And I think as my career has evolved, and I've evolved as a person and a professional, and as I've worked my way up the chain of command, I've looked at it more and more from that 30,000 foot view, and come to realize that the war on drugs was a failure, and that I spent most of my career really helping that system and being part of that system. And for me, I started to look at the system and what can I do as the leader of an agency with 163 police officers and 225 people to change the system. And I will say that I'm pretty proud of law enforcement in general, in the sense that we want to now become part of the solution rather than part of the problem. And I do think that stigma and the stigma that's created by language and terminology has been incredibly important. And I've got some friends in the room here that have kicked me around pretty good over the last few years. I've had a great education with various slip-ups, and I'll probably slip up tonight. And Andrew or Chris or somebody will throw something at me and tell me I said something wrong. So I will also say, though, while I think stigma is incredibly important, because this is truly a systemic change, we need to change at all levels, so we need to change that language. To agree with Mr. Bailey, I hope that we move as a society beyond interest to investment. Because we can change language, we can change stigma, it is incredibly important. This is a million-dollar problem, right? This is tens of millions of dollars to change the system that we need to do. So we need, at all levels, to stand up and change this narrative. And we need to do it at the dinner table. We need to do it in local government, state government, federal government, on the street corners and in venues just like this. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here.
Thank you. And in talking about changing narratives and rebuilding systems, what are some of the things, Alison, that the ACLU is doing in that effort at reform?
Well, I love hearing the chief talk, and I have to say that you know things are changing when the ACLU is allies with the police chiefs, Department of Corrections, and then we're at the same table, and then when we're battling the Department of Health and Human Services, which is really what the situation is right now in Maine. We have law enforcement, we have corrections, who are all saying that we need to change the way we look at this challenge, and yet we can't get increases in treatment, we can't get Medicaid expansion, we can't get all of the things from Health and Human Services that we need to address this issue. So I think that is really telling about where we are in Maine right now. At the ACLU, we have been across this country working on criminal justice reform. You know, I really feel like I have to stop saying criminal justice. It is a criminal injustice system, and we don't do a very good job by using that language. But we've been working on it. We've been working on it all over for decades, starting with prison reform, but increasingly looking at mass incarceration. And so we have been thinking about that in Maine. We've been working in the courts and in the legislature. And I would say, looking at one of my oldest colleagues from the back of the room there, Chris, when I started working on this issue almost 20 years ago, I felt like we could say Maine was pretty much in the forefront. We were doing a lot of good sort of progressive reform, or certainly around juveniles. And increasingly, it feels like we are falling behind. And I believe that most people are people in this room who are saying, we need to take a different direction, but we can't seem to get the legislature or even the courts to come with us. And I think it's going to take these kinds of meetings, these kinds of conversations, just like the chief said, to really drive this home, that we are simply not going to continue to engage in a failed war on drugs, that all it's done is completely rip apart families, destroy children's lives. And although we may not have a large population of communities of color, you absolutely cannot talk about this issue without talking about the obscenely disproportionate impact this has had on communities of color in Maine and all across the country.
So, Jamesa, Alison references the courts specifically. She also talked about the legislature, but I'd like to focus on the courts because she says something really insightful, and that is that some of our courts here are having a hard time making this transition that the chief has talked about. Can you tell us a little bit about that and flesh that out?
Well, I think that's true, and I think it goes primarily to your point, which is that narrative is really important. Judges need a better understanding of why someone is standing before them. They don't often get what we would call a mitigation investigation. They don't often get a very good explanation about what's happened in a person's life that's led up to their involvement in the criminal justice system. How does someone who's, you know, born with tons of potential get involved in drugs or alcohol or any sort of behavior that leads up to the criminal justice system? And without that sort of explanation in every single case, I think judges are really uninformed about how this is a human problem. This is a problem that has roots in medicine and in brain chemistry and in poverty, and it's a very sort of complex thing. It's not just a failing of moral strength, but it's much larger than that. And explaining that time and again to judges is important. And I think the defense bar could do a better job of that.
Well, I have to ask you a follow-up question, actually two. So the first is about special courts. So some judges, you're saying, could use some assistance in understanding the evolution of how the person gets in front of him or her. How about some of our innovations with drug courts, and how are they working?
Well, there's not a sort of one size fits all solution. There's co-occurring disorder courts, there's drug courts, there's veterans courts. We are trying to think creatively about ways to address this problem in a non-traditional, through non-traditional sort of litigation. The success of those programs varies widely. They have different compositions, different criteria, different characteristics throughout the state. Some are more successful than others. The Maine Criminal Defense Lawyers Association is sort of skeptical, I think, about the way some of those procedures are set up. It's a learning process. So I think it's overall a good thing, very positive thing, that we are trying different things. Whether the current, you know, incarnations are working is a different question, but it's a long process. We're in the early stages, so the positive is we're trying. Whether what's going on now is great or what we want is a different question.
And Lenny, I promise I do have a question for you, but if you want to follow up with the second question, and that's talking about the defense bar in Maine and the fact that we don't have a public defender service in Maine. And I have to say, being from another place, I was really quite surprised when I got here and found that out. So what are your thoughts about a public defender service?
Well, I too was surprised. So I sort of came up as a lawyer through a public defender system in Oregon, and then moved to Kentucky that also had a fully integrated public defender system. And I think that there's lots to be said for having an office space where attorneys are forced to sort of collaborate, or they want to collaborate, or they're encouraged to do so, where people can develop specialties within certain areas of the law. I very much enjoyed my time at a public defender office, and I think that there are wonderful attributes to having something like that. Now, the other side of the equation is that people in Maine who qualify for court-appointed counsel are very likely to get a lawyer who, in other cases, charges their, you know, $200 to $300 an hour rate. So maybe they are getting better representation or access to the same types of lawyers who are representing paying clients that they wouldn't necessarily get with the public defender office. It's a very hot button issue. I will say that I think that one of the things that Maine could do better, regardless of which system it has, is coordination and collaboration among attorneys, and substance abuse and addiction issues are a good example of that. If we all worked in a concerted way to share knowledge about what's happening in the drug court in your jurisdiction versus my jurisdiction, or how are you doing your mitigation presentation to the court, and was it successful, and why, I think we could all benefit. I think Maine could benefit from something like that.
So Lenny, Jamesa talked about the science behind addiction. What kinds of efforts does the 12-step program undertake to engage the science behind addiction? And how important is it for us to keep that in the calculus of treating individuals?
That's a great question. You know, I think in terms of the way I recovered from my own issues, I mean, because I didn't enter this field because I set out to be a do-gooder. I entered the field because I had to get well. and you know, fortunately, I had some good help to do that. In terms of the science of addiction, I think for me what's important is understanding what addiction is and what addiction is not, and you know, what it is that I suffer from. You know, which I think really kind of cuts to the whole point of this panel in a very real way. You know, do we treat it as a criminal issue? Do we treat it as a disease? I suffered from it myself and I would say I say that I have recovered from the disease of addiction, which is not the same as saying I no longer have it. Mm-hmm. You know, if I were to use alcohol or drugs today, I would, in very, very short order, be in as bad a way as I was when I had to come in. You know, I'm not, well, long period of abstinence doesn't qualify me to use responsibly. You know, if I get started, I don't have an off switch, and it's going to end in a really ugly way, and I'm going to become a danger to myself, to my community, to others, and it's not by design, because I, you know, rarely have I taken a drink or a drug with the intention of getting dangerously wasted. It's always supposed to be one or two, and it just doesn't end that way for someone who has alcoholism or addiction, and that's kind of the physical component. If I get started, I'm going to have way more than I meant to have. It's going to go on longer than it was supposed to go on, and I won't show up for things I need to show up for, and my life will fall apart. Coupled with that, though, I can't say no. And so there's a problem with my body's response to drugs or alcohol. There's also a problem with the way that I think about alcohol and drugs. I can't say no. And the 12-step approach doesn't combat the problem by medicating it. You know, what's really gonna happen is something at a far deeper level. My values need to change. Because, in terms of the causes of addiction, I think people used to think that, you know, if we dig hard enough and long enough, we'll find something awful that happened to this kid. And when we figure out what it is, it will at least make the crazy way he behaves look like it makes some kind of sense. In my case, there's no trauma like that at all. You know, I'm not like the 90% of the population that can have a couple of drinks and goes home responsibly and goes to bed. It just doesn't happen. So in my case, I don't use because something awful happened to me. I simply use because it feels great. Only I can't turn it off once I start. So what's going to happen to me is I need my values. If my values don't change, the only thing that's going to change the choices I make about using is a change in my values, my conscience. You know, if I can't start... how is the choice I'm about to make going to affect my mother needs to become more important to me than how is this going to make me feel? Otherwise, you're never going to change the choices that I make about alcohol and drugs. And that's why medicating the problem, you know, if you take somebody, it's such a complex problem, but if you just try to medicate me, that's not going to change the fact, that's not going to change all of the things that drive my bad decision making. Right, the fact that I'm lazy, that I want to take the easy way out, the fact that I have a hard time being honest consistently, the fact that, if all you've done is medicate me, those things don't change, and I'm going to find myself in trouble, and sooner or later, having a drink or a drug is going to look like a good idea again, because, you know.
I'd like to stay on this science theme, though, and ask you, not about the change in values, but how we institutionally treat people who aren't yet suffering from addiction, this wholesale prescription of medications, which some hospitals now are pushing back on and saying, why don't we use alternatives? Because they're recognizing how important the science is now with addiction. So some of these hospitals, I think St. Joseph's in New Jersey, has started to use nitrous oxide with acetaminophen instead of using opiates. Mm. And so they're recognizing the science. And again, I'm not making an excuse, but if hospitals are recognizing this, then how should the rest of us begin to incorporate that knowledge into our systems and then our decision making?
Well, one thing, you know, the opiate crisis, you know, a lot of people I think are quite rightly connecting, the prevalence of, say, OxyContin and the aggressive way it was marketed, and, you know, the maker of OxyContin eventually ended up having to pay quite a substantial fine, although probably a drop in the bucket compared to what they made, because they knew in advance what they were actually doing and how addictive it was, although they were misleading doctors on that very question. So I think this massive trend toward deregulation has been a huge contributor to the problem,
And that really gets back again to what Epley Bailey was talking about when he talked about stamina, and he talked about will, and he talked about the capacity to change. We almost have a structure, a institutional structure, that propels this kind of addiction.
That's absolutely true.
So I don't want to monopolize the entire question and answer period. Because I could. I would like to get your involvement, and I'll intersperse some questions in between. So may I ask for questions from the audience? Nice.
Hey, how many detoxes are there in the state of Maine?
How many?
Detoxes.
Detoxes. Do you mean
detoxification
centers are there in the state of Maine?
Well, you're probably right about that. There's very, very few. Mercy Hospital is gone.
They
just closed. Yeah. Here in Portland, we have Milestone.
Yeah.
And then there's still a center in Limestone.
Yes.
And I'm not sure what Bangor has, but I mean, there's just precious few resources here.
St. Mary's.
And the hospitals won't take people unless they have a chronic medical issue.
Thank you for that.
This is directed towards the chief. My question is in regards to a correction standpoint. I know you don't want corrections, but law enforcement. When I was involved in the law in a negative fashion, I never got any drug convictions per se, but the use of substances definitely influenced the choices that I made. And from 96 to 2013, you know, 8 years of my life was gone. And I guess, how do you expect people coming out of the system? Because for me, it was a revolving door for many years. And when you get released from prison in the state of Maine, it's $50 and a bus ticket. There are no halfway houses in the state of Maine, other than, I believe it's the Ferris House, but that's only for federal inmates coming out for supervised release. They just now closed up, you know, the Hollowell pre-release. And then on the inside, you know, and no one will ever understand what it's like on the inside unless you've been there. It's a totally different way of living. You have to react to certain situations. If not, you're preyed upon. The use of solitary confinement. There was an instance for me. I was locked up 23 hours a day in a cell for 6 months. And I tell you, that was, you know, very detrimental to a person's mental health. I mean, luckily when I got out this time around, I found some good support, some good friends. You know, I'm a student here at USM now. But it's like, how do people expect, you know, to be successful on the outside if you don't have the support? You know, I was lucky, I persevered through adversity this time around. And I guess I was sick and tired of being sick and tired. What's your take on it, Chief?
Yeah, and I appreciate the story. We've had an opportunity to talk in the past, and you know, there's a lot of strength in these stories because a lot of folks talk about stats and they talk about this and they talk about that, and but the personal aspects of this entire disorder world, for me, are the things that carry the day, and those are the things that are ultimately going to move the needle, and which is what we need to do, no pun intended. So, you know, to answer your question in a very succinct manner, I don't expect that people are going to change. When we put them behind bars, there's no education, there's no ongoing prevention, there's no treatment, there's no reentry plan, there's no therapeutic communities, there's no nothing, right? I mean, the definition of crazy, right? We do the same thing over and over again and we expect things are going to change. Well, I refuse to be part of that style world and expect that these things are going to happen, because they're not. And the people that we work with every day are folks that are doing that life sentence one day at a time, because we lack treatment opportunities in the community as a whole. And I can tell you that there's a lot of great folks sitting at the table. I was on the phone with a couple hours ago talking about therapeutic communities and trying to get pilot programs together in the state. This is through the Maine Opiate Collaborative, with the U.S. Attorney and the AG and Commissioner of Public Safety, trying to figure out, you know, how can we change the system, which is what we need to do. The reentry aspect of this world is incredibly important. You know, folks come out of prison, come out of the hospital setting. They go right back into the exact footprints that they were in when they went in. Same friends, same house, same phone numbers. Everybody knows you're out. Everybody's calling. How you doing? What's going on? Let's get together. And then again, we act surprised as a society when there's a high relapse rate, or recidivism rates are through the roof. So it's a great question, because I'm with you. I don't expect that there's changes in place. You know, right now, and these initiatives need to focus on prevention, treatment, and enforcement. We have to have that triangle. We have to have that three-legged stool. If we don't, we will lose. We focused on enforcement for a long time. We lost. But you can't just focus on treatment either. You have to have prevention. You have to have treatment. You have to have enforcement. You have to have the holistic approach to this, or we will continue to fail. So hopefully that answers your question, sir.
Yes, sir.
You wouldn't mind, I had the floor for about a few minutes there.
That was wonderful that you gave me forewarning.
I'm asking.
Yeah, exactly. I say you take it. Good job.
I wrote this in response to a article that's in the Portland Press Herald a couple weeks ago about the Maine House backs doubling sentences for importing heroin and other opiates. Well, I had a pretty strong opinion about that, so I wrote this. Where are the lawmakers going with their ridiculous new proposals? Apparently, they have not heard that the war on drugs is lost. Longer and harsher prison sentences for drug offenders does nothing to slow or eradicate the sale and use of illegal drugs. After 30 years of overly harsh drug prison sentences, the federal government has recently reduced the length of sentences they are given to drug offenders. It seems Maine is heading in the opposite direction. By increasing the penalties of drug offenses, the state will accomplish a few unfavorable objectives. First, it will way overcrowd the already overcrowded prison system. New prisons will have to be built at a great expense to the taxpayers. At the present financial rate of around $45,000, give or take a few thousand dollars per prisoner per year, can we afford to markedly increase the population of our penal system? Today, the American prison population exceeds all other countries in the world. Are we sure America is still the home of the free? And the lawmakers now want to increase possession charges that are now misdemeanors to felony charges, also meaning more people going to prison. Again, Maine is going against the grain. Many states are now seeing the fallacy of convicting minor drug offenses with felonies. Other states are moving in the direction of making many drug felonies to misdemeanors as not to ruin the lives of minor drug offenders. Having a felony conviction does affect the rest of a person's life. We really want to halt a person's future because that person made a bad choice, most likely at a young age. I used to think Maine was a socially progressive state, truly interested in its citizens' rights, even the downtrodden and the unfortunate people addicted to drugs. Drug uses and addiction are a social problem, not a legal problem. Hasn't the state of Maine seen the direction that the federal prison system and many state laws are going? After 50 years of getting tough on drugs, law enforcement has not worked. So now Maine is now going forward trying to implement the old school solution that has been proven not to work. So what does work? First, more treatment options for addicts. Treating those who need help is much more cost effective than incarceration. Second, education. School children should be well educated on the effects of illegal drugs starting at a young age. And thirdly, a most controversial issue is that of the illegal drug problem. Legalize most drugs. Maybe the United States should look at Sweden's drug laws. Most illicit drugs are legal, and there are far fewer drug crimes in their system. Other progressive countries are now realizing the folly of tough drug laws and are revising their laws. Why is Maine going in the proven unsuccessful way of dealing with drug problems? Being so worried about opiate overdoses would not a controlled system with controlled doses available to addicts eliminate overdose deaths? Taxation of those drugs and other harmless illegal drugs, i.e. marijuana, would more than fund treatment centers. 60% of the inmate population is drug related. By making most drugs legal and pardoning those already convicted and incarcerated would make a huge dent in the tax burden of our country and our state. Methadone is synthetic heroin that is now administered to addicts. It's far more physically damaging to an addict's health than heroin would be. These legislatures have to be stopped in trying to enact old legislation that is called prohibition. Prohibition didn't work in the 30s and still don't work today. As the old quote goes, if you don't learn from history, then you're destined to repeat it. Get off the let's jail mentality and on to the let's help them mentality. There are better ways than mass incarceration. And can all the blame be put on the dealers who sell the drugs? When starting to use hard drugs, I assume most knew the dangers of them. When putting a strong, uncontrolled dose of drugs into their system, they must realize they are playing a Russian roulette game. With a street drug like heroin, you never know what the dose may be. Every time they do a dose, it may be fatal. By the time they become addicts, they have little choice. Consequences of an overdose are ignored just to stop the oncoming withdrawal. So the people who overdose must take most of the blame for their own actions, regardless of the results, even death. I'm not saying that the drug dealer shouldn't also be responsible, but in my opinion, the addict should show the majority of his or her bad decisions to stop and continue their use of a drug known to kill people. But because of the choice he or she has made to get high, all the responsibility shifts to the dealer. People must take responsibility for their own actions, no matter what the result. Most dealers started dealing to support their own habit, at least the main people who are involved in selling drugs. Should these people be executed, or as Governor LePage advocates, or should we become a vigilante society, taking the law into our own hands, as LePage also advocates? Or not just put all the dealers and drug users to death, bring back public execution? I bet that would solve the drug epidemic. Of course, I don't advocate those drastic solutions, but it looks like Maine may be heading down that slippery slope of overzealous lawmakers bent on taking away as many rights of people as they can. We don't live in Nazi Germany yet, do we? Listen, people, you can't have a free society and a drug-free society. It's impossible. From a former federal drug prisoner of war who got out of prison 3 years early due to reduced drug prison sentences.
Thank you so much, Sam. And the three things that I'm taking from Sam's soliloquy: treatment options, education, and legalized drugs. Alison.
All three.
Okay. Let's talk about it. In order.
Yeah. I don't know, Sam. I think you might have a job at the ACLU. everything you talked about in the legislature is something that we're, you know, terribly concerned about. There does not seem to be a recognition that this is heading in the wrong direction. We will continue to fight. I mean, I know we've been in the legislature together. And we'll push in the courts, we'll push in the legislature, but it really is, I mean, you know, if I had like three wishes, I'm not sure what all three would be. I think the first one would be if I could get, you know, Fifth Avenue to take on marketing and messaging this and change the culture of how we think about substance use and substance use disorders. I think that would do so much to change the way we think about it. When I joined the ACLU 2 years ago, the ACLU was coming off of a great win with marriage equality. We're very involved with that campaign. Hugely important for the state of Maine. And I often think that one of the reasons that we won in Maine was because people could imagine their brothers, their sisters, their friends, their colleagues, and understood what that discrimination did to their lives. And I think we're having trouble making that connection for people around substance use disorder. And we're definitely, definitely far from making the connection between substance use disorder and those who've been in the criminal system. And we have to break down those barriers. We have to make people understand that these are our brothers, these are our sisters, these are our children, and their lives are being destroyed because we are really choosing to throw them away. And I think that we have to work on all these issues. Legalization is, you know, I mean, I actually talked about this earlier today, how publicly I would speak about legalization of drugs, and the ACLU has some pretty profound opinions on that. There's a lot of examples. Portugal, a lot of places would have shown that legalization does not increase use and can actually have hugely beneficial consequences to the culture. But, you know, as the chief was saying, we do have to think about the front end. We've got to stop locking up so many people. We've got to do, I really appreciated your comments about solitary. It's something we care a lot about. We have to care about how, I mean, really it's just human caging. You can call it whatever you want, but we're caging. We're caging people. And then we have to do reentry. And we have to say that we're gonna help you be part. We're going to welcome you back. And we don't do any of those things right now.
So Jamesa, I'm actually, my bedtime reading is Ta-Nehisi Coates. And I'm thinking about what he's saying about the body and how the body is the thing that our institutional enforcement personnel are striving to control. And I wonder, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot if you have or have not read the book, but I wonder how your discussions go with your clients about their lack of inviolability at such a young age, many of them, because they've been put in these situations of incarceration before they even understand what it is they've done, because maybe it happened when they were minors. And what are some of those stories like, so that we can get closer to these individuals that you represent?
Well, I can give you an example of one of my clients. So I had a client who was on death row, who got there after he had served over 500 days in solitary confinement and was getting ready to be released. And 30 days before he was scheduled to be released, the prison wanted to move him into general population, out of solitary confinement, into general population. And he begged them not to do it. He had been in solitary for so long, he had the self-awareness to know that he was just ill-equipped to move from that into a general prison population. Mm-hmm. And so the prison decided to keep him in solitary confinement until he was released out into the public. And then within days, he, according to the state, had murdered a woman and found himself on death row. And so he was convicted, and when he came to us, I was handling his capital post-conviction litigation, we spent some time with him trying to get him to understand the possible connection between all of the time that he had spent in solitary and his inability, anybody's inability, to be able to go right out into the public and respond in a way that made any kind of sense. And he couldn't see that. He could not see the connection at all. Really struggled with, my time in solitary was not that bad. It turned out I was friends with a lot of the people in the prison, which was really strange because he never talked to any of them. He was locked up in his cell the whole time. And I've had many clients where you sort of explain to them, you have to tell them, you know, you are more than this crime that you've been accused of. So many of them are just so broken down that they're not ready to process that. One of the things I have always been surprised about is, so many of my clients have been victimized by their mother, but they cannot conceive that mom, the one person in the world who's supposed to love them, could have done that, these things to them. So they never ever want to talk about their upbringing, and they can't go there. So, you know, you can have these conversations with a client. And in the case of my client who'd spent all that time in solitary, after working for many, many months with him to see that connection, I think he finally did and felt a little bit better, more self-aware, sort of in his own mind felt like, you know, this is not an excuse, but maybe this is an explanation. And it was unburdening for him. Some clients are ready to accept that and information, and some aren't, but it's a challenge.
Well, thank you for humanizing.
Sure.
So you had a question.
I do. Oh, yeah. Thank you. Hi, my name is Cynthia. My question is, what do we have in place for first offenders with crimes that are related to drugs and alcohol, to give them the option of getting treatment or getting into a program before having to go to jail? Mm-hmm. Do we have anything like that in place here in the state?
Nothing. Let me start there. Next question. I think that, you know, there are limited options. You know, deferred dispositions and things of that nature, where If an individual is arrested or becomes part of the system, starts that journey through the courts, and it's a first-time offender, it's a low-level offense, whatever that happens to be, in many cases, they will be able to work out some options with the district attorney's office with that specific set of facts in play. I've never been arrested before. This is a one-time deal. And depending on, quite frankly, the drug and the exact circumstances, the district attorneys can do a lot of things. But again, the options are limited about who they can refer to, because there are not a lot of those treatment opportunities that are out there.
Exactly.
And you know, the folks that we work with all the time are uninsured in many cases. So one of the few options in some of these cases is coming through that criminal justice system to get them plugged into some kind of a treatment option, as limited as they are. Because walking down the street, they're gonna get nothing. And that's a terrible set of circumstances to be involved with, for sure. Because at the end of the day, this is a public health emergency rather than a public safety emergency. It's just we happen to be on the tip of the spear with it in 2016, you know, for sure. But I can wish for diversion all I want to, but I have incredibly limited options for where I can send folks to, where I can work with people to try to get them the help that they need to be healthy and have a great life. And that's a tough set of circumstances, because I can tell you there's been a conversation or mentioned a couple times around felonies. And I can tell you where I started and where I am today. And in drug investigations, as an example, it's a very basic level technique is that you're just rolling people up to the next level, right? So you have somebody, a low-level offender, the vast majority of folks that are dealing drugs are middle in deals. They have a disorder issue themselves. They're trying to survive. They don't want to be sick. So ultimately, they're dealing to support their habit. And that's the world that they're trying to work on. And what the general public, they're getting high. Well, they're really trying not to get sick, is what it's a distinct difference. Getting high sounds like it's some party going on, right? This is not situations that anybody wants to be involved with. The world that they're living and working in every day is traumatic on an incredible level for the rest of their lives. So, you know, we start talking about those issues. So you roll up from one to the next levels, the next dealer. You're trying to get that big level guy, which in the state of Maine has come out of New York, come out of Connecticut, come out of Atlanta, Providence, you name it. You know, the three L's of Massachusetts, they're coming up 95 to our community.
I live there.
Yeah, well, I apologize for that, I'm sorry.
We'll talk later, but a lot of disrespect, I'm flying around next. I'm lucky to get out of here in one piece, right? So,
you know, for those circumstances, you know, we don't get our hands on those big deals, right? Those folks are staying at home, and they're sending other people up to Maine because it's a business model. You can triple or quadruple your money by buying whatever you want to buy out of state and then running it up here. And then while you're up here, you sell your drugs, you buy guns, and then you go south, and you sell them down there, and you come back the other way. I mean, it's happening all the time. So that's one aspect of that felony deal. So when law enforcement talks about, and there's stuff in the legislature right now about misdemeanor versus felony and trying to get re-felonized some of these issues, there's that one aspect that cops are afraid that they're going to lose a tool by no longer being able to roll up to the next level of drug organizations. Because if you're going to give me 48 hours in jail for a misdemeanor, I'm not rolling on anybody. I'm going to do my 48 and get out. And I'm going to go right back to doing what I'm doing. So that's, truth be told, that's where I thought in the past. The world I live in now involves the fact that, again, if I go back to a lack of diversion opportunities, a lack of treatment, I find myself cornered in many aspects to go, if I don't get this person in the criminal justice system, they're going to die. There are no options out there on the street that they have available to them. So I've got to use the courts to get them mandated to do some kind of treatment. And it's a terrible system where the carrot and the stick, neither one of them exists. The carrot is a fantasy, right? There is no treatment. There is no options. On the stick end, the felony goes away, there's no stick. So we end up as the tip of the spear with no options. And that's a tough spot to be in, because while in one time I would say I was looking for convictions and trying to bust bad guys, really we're trying to help people. And that's the world I'm living in today. That's the world I think law enforcement's heading in. But we're as trapped as everybody else. Because as a society and as our legislature, they can't get out of their own way to make a decision that's actually going to help us, which is rough.
So this lady had a question, and then what I'll do is I'll circle around this way. Is that okay?
Thank you. My name is Sarah Koop, and I manage a women's sober living home here in Portland, Maine. And it is, I try to help assist with the process of 12-step application to daily living. And you talked about science, and I just wanted to touch on that for a second. I have a comment and then a question. One of the things about the science of addiction that speaks to the women in my house is that many of these women, like 95% probably, have been through some sort of trauma as a result of their using or from their childhood that, is a root of their using. And it has to do with the reptilian brain, the triune brain, and that the frontal lobe is like completely absent. And in my using, I was a crack addict and an alcoholic for many years, and I had no higher thinking. It was very simple. I tried, it just wasn't there. I needed to get my drugs and whenever I did start to think about something, my neural pathways are so messed up that it was just, terrible. And I just went back to the drug and got myself back in that. In order to pull in, and the amygdala is at the center of that. And four times a second, our amygdala says, am I safe and do I matter? And if those two questions, if some little red light goes off, even in my sober living, if somebody's mad at somebody, oh my God, if somebody's being quiet, they think they're talking about them, that goes up, and then you got to kind of, talk them through. So to make that connection again is I think something that is, the 12-step process is very effective at doing. The opposite of addiction now is not, sobriety, it's connection. And so to have that connection with people shoulder to shoulder doing the same thing and helping each other, can grow back that ability to, this has been proven. And I learned all of this at this conference on nonviolent communication, which happened to be up in Belfast, Maine. And they have been doing this process in two corrections facilities with 0% recidivism. Not 10%, not 50%. I mean, I couldn't believe my ears when they were telling me this stuff. And then they marched up a couple of cases, and I thought these guys were in 12-step recovery by the things that they were saying. So, I think there's a lot of correlation with this stuff. And then you get the press, about the Scarborough, Operation Hope, because it was abstinence people trying to give back and to provide a place, and they were saying, oh, they're not giving a medication assisted. Right, we were giving them something. The medication assisted community would not. For some reason, that didn't make it into the paper. So this great, idea is shot down again and again. So my question is, it seems to me in the state, and I'm from here. I mean, I have a lot invested in this, and in this community. And it seems like there are so many great things going on. And like in Belfast, I don't know how to pull some of that stuff together. And I would really love to do it. I'm trying to bring standardization for sober living to Portland, like in 2 weeks is our first, coalition project, and with all these things going on. But I've asked that question to the people doing NVC up in Belfast and trying to incorporate some of this stuff, and these guys in my community, they're doing great things. It seems like there's talk going on, but the 12-step is kind of, well, we want the science. I mean, I'm definitely tracking the women in my house and success rates and stuff, but there's a lot of science behind 12-step recovery. It's just not, it's anonymous. We're coming out and not being anonymous anymore, but it gets discredited all the time because of the science, and I think it's very applicable. We just don't have an MRI machine to march everybody in at the beginning of coming to the sober living, and then when they walk out. But they're whole, So I wonder if you could speak to that a little bit, like any suggestions on how to, I believe this is it. Like, this is very close to it. But I always think that 12-step gets such a bad rap. And another issue, too, is with all of these social stigma things. I know 12-step people that are going into Long Creek. I know 12-step people that are trying to do reentry. I know 12, we're all trying to, that helps us, And so I think there's just this huge resource, and it's underserved, it's underserving because of the stigma for us, too. So I know you're touching on that, but I'd love to hear if you had any.
You're looking at me, and I'd love to say listen.
So, something that athlete Bailey said in his opening remarks, he said that our system is misnamed, you know, we call it a correction system, and it's failing at correcting people, right? You know, my own trajectory, much like Chris's, I ran afoul of the criminal justice system. And during my journey through it, access to any kind of meaningful opportunities of recovery was very, very limited. Access to much of anything that would really, you know, better someone was really limited. And so, you know, I think as a society, we really need to decide, you know, what are we doing? Are we, you know, is our mentality one of correcting, or is our mentality one of rehabilitating, or is our mentality one of punishing? And the real fervor behind the war on drugs and escalating the, you know, the crack laws and the, you know, mandatory minimums and all of that, that was a real wave of, you know, sort of this punitive lashing out. I know that in some of the federal institutions, you know, there were a variety of recreational and educational facilities that had been made available to inmates, but like there was a music room, but some overzealous senator somewhere riding this wave of, you know, hit them harder, you know, these are bad people, they shouldn't enjoy their time in prison, they should basically push through a law saying that, you know, forbidding us to invest in, to replace musical gear that broke, you know, music and other sports equipment that broke, so that basically, you know, things were duct taped together and, you know, when they were gone, they were gone. That same guy ended up going to federal prison for accepting a bribe, which amused me to no end. But, you know, if we really need, as a society, to decide, are we going to make opportunities to better, you know, for these inmates to better themselves available to them? It's really difficult. You know, you're right. There is there are people in the recovery community working very hard to take, you know, genuine 12-step recovery, to take inmates through the 12 steps, because it's not just going to meetings, it's actually taking a hard look at yourself, how you're living your life, what really is important, what you've been treating like it's important, what you should be treating like it's important. You know, if somebody doesn't have this, you know, what the hell have I been doing with my life epiphany, and really dedicate themselves to living a better way, they're going, you know, we have all kinds of, you know, lifetime's worth of bad habits that we're likely to repeat. And that's why 12-step recovery can produce such a dramatic change in people. But it's incredibly hard to interface with the jails and the institutions, and to get to talk to somebody who can actually say yes or no, you can come into this prison, here's how to do it. They do orientations very, very rarely. You know, the requirements are hard to figure out, and, you know, so it's very complicated to interact with them. That I'd love to see change, you know. I don't know, there's a lot of change. Oh, another thought that I had listening to everything. You mentioned the MDEA, right, the Maine DEA. You know, they probably saved my life by arresting me. So, you know, I actually, you know, I have to admit that, you know, it wasn't all a bad thing when I got arrested. But that made me think, you know, in Massachusetts, they have something called Section 35, where somebody who's, you know, a drug addict, can, their family, or, in, you know, if they choose to turn themselves in, they can put themselves in protective custody for 30 days, and it dries them out, and it buys a terrified family 30 days to make a cogent plan for what the hell do we do with them when they get out of jail, you know, out of protective custody. I'd love to see something like that available to families in Maine. That would be a really constructive thing that the criminal justice system could offer. Again, that would come from a mentality of, you know, we want to help these people.
My question is about the role of technology, which is the great American panacea for everything. And I was just curious if people have started to think about, you know, technology and data, you know, management and things like that. Obviously, privacy rights and things like that are an issue. But, you know, caseworkers and law enforcement and courts can share information and medical professionals quickly and sort of identify somebody's, you know, sort of addictive history. Is that something that people out in the field could, you know, wish they had as a tool from time to time in sort of getting that quick snapshot of somebody in their whole history? And is anybody been experimenting with that kind of, you know, sharing across platforms?
Well, I love the question because today in my criminal law seminar, I invited a sociologist from Bates to come talk about some of the research that he's doing, and he spent a lot of time talking about how difficult it is to get data and how expensive it is, and then how much it costs to interpret that data and how poorly it's kept. So, for example, in the state of Maine, the Maine Commission on Indigent Defense Legal Services, which pays for the criminal defense lawyers to represent everyone, they don't track how many cases go to trial. So there's a lot of numbers that we are missing. And when you think, and this isn't just in Maine, this is everywhere, when you think how many billions of dollars we're spending on the criminal justice system, and there are just key data points that we're not tracking and we're not analyzing. And so we don't necessarily know if we're spending the money well. We can't really make a good case because we just don't have all the information. I think that is a big failing. And I am absolutely confident that tracking and interpreting that data will pay for itself tenfold once we figure out how we're spending our money and whether it makes sense to spend the money the way we're spending it. It's just not being done, and it's shocking. It's really shocking that taxpayers will allow that much money to be spent on a criminal justice system and not want to see some level of accountability, where the proof is in the pudding. Are the numbers showing that we're spending that money wisely? And we all suspect the answer is no, but it's difficult to actually prove that without having the numbers.
There were two other people that I wanted to get who had their hands raised. And that was this gentleman and this young man.
Can I just jump on that one just real quick?
No, sorry. I'll get you later, man.
Angus Ferguson, I practice in criminal law with occasional help from Jamie. Jamie, you talked a little bit about doing more mitigation, or that is more telling folks' story at sentencing to persuade judges maybe to sentence more appropriately. I'm interested in you speaking also about the problem of mandatory sentences, which means the judge doesn't have the discretion, and the pressures of the plea bargaining system.
Sure. Well, that's a lot in there. One of the results of a plea bargaining system, and that's what we have right now. At the federal level, something like 97% of all cases are resolved by plea, and those numbers are about at the state level too, is that it takes much of the discretion away from the court and puts it in the hand of prosecutors, who, in the words of very famous Supreme Court justice in a very old case called United States versus Johnson, say they're involved, prosecutors are involved in the competitive enterprise of the prosecution of crime. So their incentives are sort of skewed. And this dovetails, I think, to your question about mandatory sentences. We're studying, lots of information is coming out about just how did we start the war on drugs? How did that begin?
And we're getting a lot of interesting information about people who worked in the Nixon administration suggesting that this was actually sort of a concerted sort of scare tactic that wound up to working really well. It was a great political pitch that the American public bought. And so politicians did well when they got tough on crime and gave us mandatory minimum sentences. Today, mandatory minimum incarceration sentences of incarceration, are becoming rare. The federal sentencing guidelines are non-binding, for example. And yet, we still see very harsh, very lengthy prison sentences. And so one of the questions that I have is, how did we co-opt judges with lifetime tenure into the war on drugs? If it's politically expedient, it works well, it makes sense for politicians to get tough on drugs, why did judges go along with that if they're not running for re-election? What was in it for them? They're going to keep their job regardless of whether they give a harsh sentence or a shorter sentence. But mandatory minimums, together with the plea bargaining system, I mean, a defendant who's facing a very lengthy sentence is going to be interested in a plea bargain and will be pressured based on the sentence. That will be the calculation, not on whether they were actually culpable. They're just mitigating their loss. It's a risk calculation at that point. And that's detrimental not only to the individual client, but to all of us, because now we are incarcerating lots of people who may be actually innocent. They just were smart enough to say, if I roll the dice, I'm going to get a very lengthy sentence, and if I take a deal, I'm not going to. And I think that runs counter to what we really think about the criminal justice system, which is we should only be incarcerating people who are guilty, and we should be only doing it to a degree that's commensurate with their crime. But that gets distorted with a system that has very lengthy sentences and that encourages discretion at the hands of prosecutors.
So there's one more question I'm going to allow, and that's this young man. We are at 8:05, and I encourage you after Chris Poulos comes back up to finalize the program, I encourage you to stick around and think about how we respond, what's the next step to this panel. So.
Thank you. This might be a tough question to answer, but sometimes tough questions get the best answers. A few years ago, I wrote my thesis paper on the war on drugs and how it's just unconstitutional for many reasons, but even if it was constitutional, it's not really serving any compelling purpose. It's doing the opposite. It's counterproductive and it's destructive to the individual, corrosive to societies. And we're all obviously here tonight because we realize that, and luckily there has been a move towards more sensible drug policy. But I'm wondering what your opinions are on the timeline for that, how quickly that should happen. You know, if there was a wise man or woman in some office high up that tomorrow could, you know, change Maine's laws and release, you know, certainly all low-level nonviolent drug possession offenders from prison and stop arresting people for walking around with, you know, a bag, 20 bucks worth of powder, you know. How quickly would it be ethical to, you know, or would it be right, you know, lacking the support networks for these people, would that be ethical, I guess, to do overnight? I'm a big fan of, you know, the line from Dr. King's letter from Birmingham Jail, justice too long denied is justice delayed. Just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Well, I refuse to believe that there's any reason to not bring people back into the community. I don't think there's any, I'm sure there will be consequences, but we have been jailing far too many people for far too long, and I don't see any reason not to. I mean, we talk about the unconstitutionality of the war on drugs. I mean, there's so many different points in the process that there are, you know, significant constitutional problems. So I think that we're going to get to that we're going to get there quickly only by engaging with unusual allies. So hearing the chief talk, his words, I mean, not that I don't believe in the power of the ACLU, but I have to be honest, when the chief talks about the importance of rethinking the framework for how we handle substance abuse disorders, that carries weight that some of us in the advocacy community can't bring. And just like nationwide, and unfortunately not in Maine, much more conservative groups are joining with the ACLU. I mean, there's a huge partnership between, I mean, you have the Koch brothers who are getting, now you can question their intent, but it is undeniable that they're putting huge resources into criminal justice reform, Newt Gingrich, lots of people. And so I think that we have to be open to working with lots of different people in our community. And I think the one group that we haven't, I believe, talked about enough are the prosecutors. And I think that we need to, I mean, district attorneys are elected in every county. And you should know how your district attorney runs their system and whether they're engaged. And we have a diversion program in Augusta right now that is dying because they won't appropriate the money it's going to take. And dying is strong, but I don't mean, but that is, it is like, it's a possible outcome because there's an appropriation attached to it. So we as advocates need to engage and think about the people who are making decisions. Having, you know, having Mike here to advocate in Portland has been a huge advantage in moving the community. So we all should take an active role in knowing who our elected officials are and what are their positions on this. And I would say, I mean, there's so many people who have been affected by this issue, and I would encourage you, the legislature is a wild place for those of you who have known. Some strange things happen, but some really beautiful things happen too. And very rarely do just people come and talk to them. You know, I'll stand up, or, you know, there's some of us in the room who go up regularly, but people don't always come and tell their stories. And it's a human, Chris was there, and you were there the other day, I remember hearing your story, and I can't imagine how much bravery it takes, but I can tell you, those legislators are listening. They're not checking their phone. They might be when I'm talking, but they're not. And so, you know, follow what we're doing at the ACLU. We put out calls for people to come join us in the legislature. There are other great advocacy groups here that are doing that too. You know, just stay engaged, because it is going to be, we probably are going to win this person to person, one-on-one, with some, you know, huge steps forward and a little fall back. And so, but knowing things like, you know, and I couldn't leave without talking about the prosecutor, so I don't know if you want to weigh in on that.
That would be my, I'm going to ask you, let's not to. For a lot of reasons. One of which is because I haven't eaten since like 10 a.m. So I feel myself shaking up here. But I just want to say, I am so proud to be not only a member, a new member of the Maine community, I'm very proud to be the Dean of the University of Maine School of Law. Thank you. Yeah. And the reason is just what you see here, the production of this panel and the speaker, and the knowledge that's been disseminated here comes directly from our law students. And that's why I am beaming with pride. And Chris Poulos represents our many students. But his story is compelling, and I think it's wonderful to listen to this handsome young man over here. Yeah, to you. You need to pop over to the law school, and all of you need to pop over to the law school and look at what we're doing and see how what we're doing can fit into what your lived experience is. Mm. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Chris Poulos.
What a great event. Mm. This is probably the last time I'll be behind a podium as president of the American Constitution Society, and maybe as a law student. I'm trying to focus on finals for the next couple weeks. I am still a student. One thing I need to touch on is that as this shift happens, when we're shifting from a criminal justice law enforcement approach to addiction toward a public health based approach to addiction, we need to make sure that the most vulnerable people in our communities, the most vulnerable communities, are included in this change. And that this change, let's face it, it happened because affluent white people started dying in large numbers from opioids. We acknowledge that. Now that we have this change, what are we going to do with it? We need to seize on this moment, and we need to make sure the policies we change do not just help the communities that hold the power and hold the influence, but also help the most vulnerable people in our communities. Mm. I have the absolute honor right now to currently represent juveniles who are facing criminal charges in the very same courts where I was once both a juvenile and an adult defendant. And the common denominator between all these kids is their life circumstances growing up. There's not one single kid that grew up on a house on the ocean in Cape Elizabeth who comes before me. It's the same story. I had a single mom growing up. I knew what it was like to have lots of problems as a child and some instability. I also had a lot of advantages too that these kids didn't have, and I will own that as well. But what I see this common denominator is that people in affluent communities, affluent families are insulated from the criminal justice system. There's very little contact. When a child in Falmouth overdoses or is using, the chances that the go-to thing is going to be a beat cop interacting with this person immediately is remote. Whereas in other communities that don't have the resources, police contact is a normal thing. And so what we're doing with the chief and with the Portland Police Department, we're developing ways to change the relationship between law enforcement and the most vulnerable people of these communities. Mm. So I just wanted to touch on that as we change this, we need to make sure we include everyone along with it and make sure that the supports are in place. Hmm. Marty,
yeah.
I wanted to also recognize the board of ACS for all of the help that ACS has. So Secretary Marty Mayer, 2L, Rising 3L, she will be our president as soon as the semester's done, so talk to Marty if you're interested in ACS. I'd like to thank Hannah Anderson, our vice president, and I'd like to thank Cameron Kaufman, who has a mouthful in the back, who is our treasurer. And thank you all and everyone involved in ACS that made this happen. Thank you very much. And to all the panelists, thank you.
What is that?
Somebody was talking, I don't know. And to Mr. Bailey, of course, thank you for coming. Everyone that's participated in this, I really appreciate it. We appreciate it. It's been a great night. Thank you.